Here at the Warpinger, microphones will be on now, except during closed session. Please remember to speak clearly, one person at a time if possible, and say your name when you begin so the people who are on the phone and online can follow what's going on. We have no remote board members today. Community members who plan to speak, please come to the podium if you are able so the microphone can pick up your voice. Online participants, click the raise hand button in the webinar controls, and phone participants, please press star 9 to raise your hand and star 6 to unmute. Please raise your hand early so staff doesn't miss calling on you. And public comment may be limited to 3 minutes at the chair's discretion. Email public comments are being accepted at publiccomment@redwoodenergy.org until the chair closes the public comment period for that agenda item. And remote participants, if your meeting connection is disrupted, please try to notify us if you can by calling or texting 707-382-7336, 707-382-7336, or by emailing publiccomment@redwoodenergy.org. Vice Chair Bond.
Thank you, Lori. Welcome, everyone. I'd like to call the August 22nd, 2024 meeting of the RCA Board of Directors to order. May we have a roll call, please?
Yes, Vice Chair. Director Arroyo.
Here.
Vice Chair Bauer.
Here.
Director Jorgensen.
Here.
Director Chris Mobley is absent. Director Frankie Myers is absent. Director Jason Ramos is absent. Here. Director Stefani.
Here.
Thank you. Chair Schaefer is absent. Director Tuttle.
Here.
And Director Wilson.
Here.
Director Wu.
Here.
There is a quorum for regular NCCE business.
Excellent. So that was item one. Item two is report from member entities. Do we have anything to report? Jack.
Yeah, I know that the RCA is partnership with Swell Energy. And in my line, what I've been hearing in my industry is Swell Energy is no longer, or they're ceasing to operate. So I just wanted to bring that to the board that we might need another partnership within the company.
I have an update about that
okay.
in the ED report.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? All right. On to item three, oral written communications. This time is provided for people to address the board or submit written communications on matters not on the agenda. At the conclusion of all oral communications, the board may respond to statements. Any request that requires board action will be set by the board for a future agenda or refer to staff. Did you receive any written comments?
We did. There were three comments regarding biomass, distributed solar, and co-grazing for microgrids. All in support. You can see those on Redwood Energy.
All right, thank you. Any oral communications? No? All right, on to the consent calendar, item four. All matters on the consent calendar are considered to be routine by the board and are enacted in one motion. There is no separate discussion of any of these items. If discussion is required, that item is removed from the consent calendar and considered separately. At the end of the reading of the consent calendar, board members and members of the public can request that an item be removed for separate discussion. Does anybody have something to pull?
I'll pull 4A.
Yeah, thank you for doing that. Do we have a motion for remaining?
I'll move the remainder of the consent calendar.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Roll call. Raise your hands. You approve?
Motion passed.
All right. Thank you. Item 4.8, County CAC nominee Benjamin Fordham.
Yeah, want to take a second to introduce yourself?
Sure.
Come to the podium, please.
Yeah, hello everybody. I'm going to some of you, but not all of you. I'm Benjamin Fordham. I'm originally from the area, so kind of understand the area pretty well. I understand kind of the CCA space pretty well. One of my mentors was pretty involved in getting some CCAs formed in California. So I have a pretty good understanding of kind of how they function, what the benefits are and things like that. So, you know, it's something I believe I'm very strongly in. And then professionally, I've worked on like some renewable energy planning, climate action planning efforts and things like that. So kind of some relevant work experience there. So, you know, I was looking for an opportunity to give back to my community. This seemed like a good fit. So, you know, I'm excited for this. And I'm here just kind of without an agenda. I'm just here to kind of listen and learn and contribute in ways that make the most sense. So thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming. Any questions? Right.
I'll just comment if I can.
Yeah.
I had the opportunity to check in with you and to learn about your interests and background. And I just think Benjamin would be an awesome addition. And thank you so much for applying and being willing to be part of this.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have a motion?
Oh, I move approval of 4.8.
Motion in a second. We need a roll to hold his hands. Show hands. Thank you, Benjamin.
Yes.
Stick around. Thanks. All right. Community choice energy business. We have a quorum for that.
Yes, we do.
All right. We'll start with item 6, old CCE business. 6.1 energy risk management quarterly report, and I believe staff provides report.
Yep, we have Jacqueline Har online. I think she's being promoted now to give the quarterly report.
Hello, RCA board. You all can hear me all right?
We can hear you, but we can't see you.
Okay, I have my video turned on. I can see myself. Is there just not a screen?
It's an us issue.
Okay, all right. Well, I'll plow forward with the presentation. If we can see each other at some point during it, that'll be great. But otherwise, we can just move on. My apologies for not being able to be there in person. It's the first day of school here. In Berkeley, so it's been a bit of a unusual schedule week for me. All right, moving on to the next slide, just to cover the agenda that's on. We have a few brief slides on first the 2024 summer assessment, although we are in late August, so we're getting close to the end of summer. And then we have a couple slides on the Diablo Canyon Power Plant nuclear allocation. This is informational only, but I believe staff will be potentially bringing this to the board for your decision in future months. And then we have the standard financial update. Moving on to the next slide for the 2024 summer assessment. So this is an assessment that TA staff and RCA staff do in conjunction with each other at the beginning of each summer. It's completed in May or early June each year. And it typically follows the CAISO's own publication of its summer assessment. So in the summer assessment, which I believe RCA staff has posted to the RCA website, first we review the CAISO summer assessment and, you know, replicate some of the more important information within that summer assessment, as well as, you know, occasionally commenting on, you know, whether we think that the CAISO's positioning of the information is, you know, completely accurate or not. And it's very easy to say this now that we're mostly over the hump of the summer, but you know, it does look like the CAISO summer assessment was accurate in that there was limited concern regarding summer market conditions. That is what has played out. Demand has been relatively low overall. We had some heat in early July, but not a lot otherwise. You know, knock on wood that I haven't just jinxed us for September in terms of high loads and high heat. You had average to slightly above average hydro conditions, which has helped the resource stack. And there's also been a lot of resource development, which, you know, Redwood has been playing its own role in that as well, of bringing lots of solar online, more wind, and especially batteries. And what we've seen play out over the summer, in line with what the assessment was suggesting, is that, you know, all of those factors have really strengthened California's resource stack and has reduced the potential of, you know, I don't want to take say eliminate because we're, you know, just one summer through, but what we've built out in California the past few years seems to be really helping in terms of having sufficient capacity to meet supply or demand. So that's fantastic. And then when we turn ourselves to Redwood's, you know, as its utility, its summer assessment, you know, how prepared is Redwood for the summer? First, you know, we look at hedging to manage price volatility risk. And this is something we look at every, you know, May and June to look for the whole period of June through August and then September as well. And on average, Redwood has been well hedged in meeting its risk policy with respect to hedging targets for the summer period. In addition, Redwood met all of its monthly RA compliance requirements, which supports grid reliability, which is really fantastic news. You know, I've come to you in the past and said RA prices are through the roof, and they have been, and they are in the lead up to the annual filing, which happens in the fall for the next year. So right now, if we were thinking of buying RA for 2025 for September, that costs about $100 per kilowatt month. And it was similar prices when we were in the lead up to the annual showing last year for this summer. What happened this summer is as we got closer into the summer period, prices really dropped and we were able to meet RCA's RA compliance requirements at much more reasonable prices of, you know, $20 to $30 per kilowatt month. So pretty dramatic drop. There's a lot of reasons that go into that, you know, some market power ones, perhaps, some about those resources that have been coming online and adding to the stack and then, you know, provides additional capacity that loads of entities can sell in the market. But, you know, whatever view you take on why prices dropped, and we have many competing theories, the positive news is that they did drop and Redwood was able to meet its monthly RA compliance requirements for the summer, which is great. All right. That's all I have for the summer assessment slide. Moving on to the next slide, Diablo Canyon Power Plant allocation. I realize there's a lot of numbers up here. So let me walk you through this really quickly. So to set the stage, as I think most of you are aware, PG&E owns two units of Diablo Canyon Power Plant. These units were set to retire, with one retiring at the end of this year and the other one retiring in 2025. The state took action over the past few years to extend the lifetime of these power plants in order to ensure that there would be enough capacity to help California meet its reliability requirements, you know, so that we would have enough in the stack for these summer months. And so those plants now have been extended to not retire any earlier than 2030. As part of this process of extending the lifetime of these resources, while PG&E will still operate the Diablo Canyon power plant, it will no longer be the sole off-taker of the power plant. Instead, all CPUC jurisdictional entities will help pay for Diablo Canyon, and all of them have the option of receiving an allocation from that power plant of its output. And the item, the particular item here to speak to you today about is the carbon-free allocation that would be coming from Diablo Canyon Power Plant. And the rationale here is that, you know, this is carbon-free energy, but it's coming from nuclear source, which I know, you know, members of the community, perhaps members of the board, have concerns about. So what I have in front of you are three different options regarding where RCA could be in terms of having renewable and carbon-free in its portfolio under different scenarios around carbon-free procurement, as well as accepting or not accepting the carbon-free allocation. To be very clear about that carbon-free allocation, all Redwood Coast customers, as well as everyone else in the state that belongs to a utility or CCA, are going to help pay to keep Diablo Canyon running. So you're paying either way for the operation of that facility, but you have the option to accept the allocation or to refuse it. If you accept the allocation, there is no additional cost of accepting the allocation. As I'm sure the board is aware, currently we have a goal of being 100% carbon-free energy in 2025 and 2026. Through action earlier this year, the board has put a pause on the 2025 goal, given financial concerns. So as it stands in that first line item there, no additional carbon-free procurement. If Redwood does no additional procurement of carbon-free resources or additional renewable resources, Redwood's resource or supply mix will be 89% carbon-free. Well, 89% of a combination of renewable or carbon-free energy. So renewable coming from largely from Sandrini Solar, also from the Redwood Coast microgrid. Some of that renewable we are counting as coming from Humboldt Sawmill Company, which I know is not carbon-free in the same sense that, say, hydro is carbon-free, but it does count as renewable. So it's being put within that percentage due to kind of how these resources are counted. And then you also get a small carbon-free allocation from PG&E's hydro system. So all of those added together get you to a forecast 89% combo of renewable and carbon-free. Then in this first scenario, we're assuming you do no additional carbon-free hydro procurement, and you also do not accept the Diablo Canyon allocation. So you stay with the same percentage of 89%. As we'll get into the fiscal slides in a few slides, unfortunately, right now, we are forecasting a negative net revenue for 2025, which in this scenario puts you at negative $4.7 million for the year. For 2026, kind of the same analysis, just slightly different numbers, 83% renewable plus carbon-free, net positive for that year of $2.5 million. In the second scenario, instead of sticking with what your current resource stack would put you in terms of your renewable and carbon-free percentage, we assume that you do all the additional carbon-free hydro procurement, which is a little over, close to 70,000 megawatt hours needed in 2025, and an additional amount, a little bit more needed in 2026. To get to that 100% goal. Obviously, that comes at a cost of about $2.1 million in 2025 and a little bit more in 2026 because you're buying more volume in that year. So that leads you to a higher deficit in 2025 and flips you from being somewhat positive in 26 to a teeny bit negative in the current forecast. The third procurement scenario here is still the goal. I'm sorry, I just noticed that there is one clerical error. It shouldn't be 100% in that first line. The existing should still be 89 in 2025 and 83 in 2026 in that third scenario. But we do get to 100% this time by both accepting the Diablo Canyon allocation as well as doing additional carbon-free procurement to get to that 100%. So you can see the cost there is less. The cost of the additional carbon-free procurement is about $900,000, but you're also getting that free Diablo Canyon allocation, which is just significantly more than actually the hydro procurement that you would need to do. So less negative in 25 compared to buying it all from carbon-free hydro, and then more positive in 2026. If we move on to the next slide, because I know that's a lot of numbers and a little difficult to digest, I have sort of the same general information visually, which will hopefully make it a bit easier. So I'm showing scenarios 1 and 3 up here. So on 1, we have no additional carbon-free procurement from what's already in your portfolio for 25 and 26. So looking at the bar chart, the green is all of the renewables in your portfolio, very healthy. We're very glad Sandrini Solar is coming online. And then you get an additional incremental carbon-free hydro. That's your allocation from PG&E. So that's the bar chart. And then the lines, the yellow line shows you the state RPS obligation, you know, how much renewable do you need per state compliance rules. The dark blue shows your renewable target that has been set, adopted by the board and staff. So in that case, you know, you're still healthily within the margin of meeting your goals when it comes to renewable. And then the light blue line up at the very top is your 100% renewable and carbon-free target. So that's where you would need to get the lines to be 100% renewable plus carbon-free or clean energy. And then the chart on the right shows the same information. Nothing has changed except for the addition of the Diablo Canyon allocation. So you can see that, well, and also additional carbon-free hydro and the combination of those two gets you over the hump to 100% renewable plus carbon-free. There's also, of course, the option of something in between here. So not buying all of the hydrocarbon-free, but maybe buying some or accepting the Diablo Canyon allocation, but not procuring any additional carbon-free hydro. So, you know, there are variations amongst this. This is just a selection of potential procurement scenarios. You know, sell some of your renewables, buy more carbon-free because carbon-free is less expensive than renewables, like, right? So there's a lot of different procurement options with on the table, but this is meant to be a selection of possible options. And I'll take a pause here in case staff wants to add any additional information or if the board has any questions before I jump into the finance slides. Again, this is just information only. We want to raise this to the board's attention because this decision of whether to accept the allocation or not will be coming relatively soon in the next few months.
Yeah, and Jacqueline pretty much just reiterated what I was about to say there at the end, which was just that this is informational only today, and we plan to come back probably in September because the decision is due this fall on whether to accept this allocation or not. So really, it's kind of a temperature check today just to see what the board's thoughts are and just to help inform what proposal we bring to you for next month.
Any questions?
Dumb question. Why wouldn't we accept the free Diablo power, the Diablo Canyon power? Is there, I mean, it's being phased out already. It's not like it's continuing to choose nuclear by accepting the allocation. Is there some reason that I'm not understanding about why we would say no thank you?
Well, we've been hearing discussions that other CCAs have been having about this subject, and they do seem to be coming down on the side of it sort of being a no-brainer to take it since we're paying for it. Mm-hmm. It will show up in our power content label as having some nuclear. And I know for one that AVA, which used to be East Bay Clean Energy or East Bay Community Energy, you know, serving Alameda County and some surrounding communities, that has gotten significant pushback from anti-nuclear folks in their community who look at this and say they're not just looking at through the fiscal lens. They're just saying we want to do something that just in a way continues to promote nuclear power being an acceptable part of utility portfolios. So
and we have a no nuclear policy. So we would even if we're not paying for it, it would show up. And we would have to adjust that.
Yeah, and I did want to mention that because if you look at our risk policy, there is a section in there on prohibited sources, and nuclear is listed as one of them. The one workaround for that is that this is an allocation that we would be taking 1 year at a time, so it would not count as a long-term. It would be a short-term allocation in any given year, and there is language in the risk policy that's sort of an exception for the prohibited sources that says for short-term purposes, there can be exceptions made. So you probably would not actually have to formally amend the risk policy if you wanted to take it.
How long is the Amble Canyon extended for?
It's up to 5 years, up to 2030 at this point. I think it's anybody's guess what will really happen in the long term, but according to the decision that was made on this, it was to take it out to 2030.
And do they have a long-term plan what to do without the Amble?
That's partly why offshore wind is so important now, especially the Central Coast, Morro Bay lease area, because that could conveniently kind of plug into the grid right where Yeah, Canyon was currently plugged in. But offshore wind is not a big slow resource like nuclear, so it doesn't solve the problem in and of itself of what resources exactly will replace the nuclear plant. We do see a big ramp up in energy storage, especially battery energy storage projects right now. So I think a combination of energy storage and intermittent resources like wind and solar is what's going to be online, hopefully in enough quantity by 2030 to really let the nuclear plant unplug.
Director Wu?
Frank, ask my question.
I appreciate Natalie, but I will say, as one that's never been a big fan with a spent fuel that lasts for, what, 1,000 generations or something like that, with no storage yet figured out, that I can't support anything like nuclear, because if we care about future generations, they're gonna have to deal with, you know, hot material, that radioactive material that lasts forever, essentially. But I understand at the same time, you've kind of got it, it's gonna be there, but I wouldn't support it. Or sewing, just from thinking about the kids' situation.
Whether we RCEA decided to accept the Diablo Canyon, it's gonna, if we didn't, then somebody, other CCAs or other power utilities would.
It is my understanding that different load serving entities can take an allocation if it's refused, because we did have been some discussion with other CCAs the other day. One of the CCAs mentioned that their intent was to take additional allocations beyond what's being offered to them if there are refusals by other LICs. I don't know the exact mechanics of how that works. You could maybe, okay, it sounds like Faith has some input on that. Please step up.
Just a couple of points that I wanted to make here. And I personally have very mixed feelings about nuclear. We are already paying for this, whether we accept the allocation or not. Secondly, currently there is, I believe, only one CCA accepting these allocations. So it just goes back into the pool, and effectively the IOUs will end up using it and benefiting from that financially that we are already paying for.
I'm sure it'll drop our prices.
So yeah, it's information only, not my favorite thing to before the board, but yeah, I just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, Director
Royal. Thank you, Director Bauer. I know we're making this decision today, but I want to clarify, and I think, you know, many of our municipalities and lots of jurisdictions have anti-nuclear policies in the books, and I know we do as an organization, and so it is, of course, contentious. If this was a question about whether to support development of a new nuclear facility, it'd be an entirely different conversation for me. But based on the understanding from the presentation that this was already something that we're paying for and a temporary allocation, I'm still, it's another one of those hold your nose and maybe do it for fiscal reasons type decisions. It might work, but I also am open to more discussion about it and hearing. We know it's being decommissioned, and this is sort of its final days. But if we feel that our customers are just absolutely cannot support nuclear, even under these circumstances, I think that's a important consideration as well, and I certainly want to have the trust of our customers and our organization. I don't think we want to signal that we are all for development of additional nuclear power sources necessarily. Maybe that's a different board conversation, but I just, under these particular circumstances, I would be inclined to accept.
Can we go back to the previous slide to see what our financial picture would be?
Mm-hmm. Well, and that bottom is including purchasing hydro.
Yeah.
So we could, what Jacqueline was clarifying, we could accept which isn't listed here, except the allocation from Diablo Canyon and not purchase additional, which would put us back at the negative 4.7, but increase our renewable and carbon free.
Yeah. Financially, it would be the same as that first line item. So negative 4.7 million in 25, positive 2.5 in 26. And then in terms of the carbon, the renewable plus carbon free percentage, you'd be sitting somewhere around 95% or so of your clean energy goal.
Can you tell us what percentage of our procurement budget is going to Diablo Canyon? Or will be going to Diablo Canyon? The cost that we're paying in?
Yes. So that's a complicated question. It's actually not going to be paid directly by, so this is something that the state is still working out in terms of the structure of it and kind of the policy of it. We actually don't even have a final allocation number. This is just our estimate based on the information that we do have. Diablo Canyon allocation will be roughly, or what we forecast it to be, is roughly 6 to 6.6% of your load. So that is how it will be impacting your load. The way that the payment will likely come out is as a line item on all Redwood Coast customers' bills, as long as well as a line item on everyone who is within an IOU service territory's bills. So it'll just be a line item that you receive, whether you're a CCA customer or an investor-owned utility customer. And I am sure there will be some sort of estimate to start paying for it in 25. There will also likely be a very large true-up process because the estimate of the cost of operating the plant is only that, an estimate, and it can actually vary relatively significantly from year to year. So I know that wasn't the answer to your question, but I think the answer is we aren't really sure, but it's not going to come through Redwood Coast directly.
Well, potentially 6 to 7% of our energy costs will go to support Diablo Canyon. And is that a proportional amount of power that would be coming back to us?
That is the amount of power coming back to us. I don't think it's a good indicator of cost because we don't know the cost of nuclear relative to the other resources in our portfolio.
Okay, so we can be paying many times that for the actual power or less.
Conceivably less, yeah. No, yeah, unknown at this time.
I would say probably more expensive than your portfolio. Nuke plants are expensive to operate.
Does the board ever find out what we're going to pay for the nuclear plant? Or is that always rejected?
It's going to be on customer bills. RCA is not going to pay anything. So every customer is going to pay into the Diablo Canyon. And RCA can choose whether or not to get the allocation of that credit of the power. But regardless if we take it or not, we will all be paying it on our bills.
Even people that opted out, as well as people that stayed in the CCA.
Yeah. And so that's why, I mean, that's part of the reason to bring it, because it's going to impact our customers one way or another if we accept the allocation or not.
And as Jocelyn just mentioned, this is already showing up on customer bills because this is already spread across the customer base to pay for running Diablo Canyon. So we've got those. This is the public purpose charge. Is that the
it's
one?
It's in the PCA.
It's in the PCA. Okay. So it's the power charging difference adjustment that we pay that is scaled to how much energy you use. So individual customers' PCIA could be higher or lower depending on their usage, and it's embedded in there.
So this will sustain the grid. That's why you have to keep Diablo online, is to sustain the grids.
For reliability, that's why they
do. We're getting our power by purchase, by not using any of that sustainability. Does that seem strange to anybody, or is it just me saying that it seems a little strange? I figured you would be.
Yeah.
I know she got it.
I just want to clarify, we have been getting a nuclear allocation offering from PG&E for the last several years. We have rejected it every year. I think CCAs are now reevaluating this opportunity because, which does come to us every year, we have the opportunity to accept or reject it. And, you know, because of the financial situation right now with how expensive power is and how challenging it is to get large hydro in the portfolio, because, you know, that's the other carbon-free resource, CCAs are now kind of reconsidering this. So that's why we're bringing it to you.
The other thing I would add to Jocelyn's excellent point is, you know, at one point when this was just being offered by PG&E in previous years, it was for CCAs within the PG&E service territory. And now this is being offered to all CPC jurisdictional entities. So SoCal, SDG&E as well.
I think what I'm hearing is it's worth more discussion. I think, you know, what Richard said is a temperature check if everyone was like, we don't even want to talk about it, you know, put this to bed, we wouldn't. But I think we'll bring it back as a standalone agenda item.
Do we need to include policy change in that same discussion?
Staff's interpretation is not, I'd like to check in with our general counsel on that before we really definitively say that, because that's just Eileen's and my kind of initial read of the risk policy, but it would be helpful to get your thoughts, Tennessee.
Sure.
I think just one closing point I'd make in response to Director Bauer's comments was, I do think, you know, this is the last operating nuclear plant in California, but there are proposals to build new nuclear plants in California and elsewhere in the country. And I think that potentially it does, you know, create a narrative that might bolster those efforts if there are a larger number of long-serving entities in California that can show nuclear power in their portfolios that they willingly took on. So I guess that maybe is one counter argument if you're looking ahead to the future and not just thinking about this as, you know, an old plant on its last legs.
Thank you. Any further questions? We'll continue.
All right. Let's move on a couple of slides to the start of the financial presentation. So a lot of changes since I was last in front of you back in April. All these changes are relative to the presentation that you saw in April. So first, on the revenue side, in 2024, RCE rates moved in concert with PG&E rates, and that led to an increase in the forecasted revenue as the rates increased mid-year slightly. However, I will just note kind of on the revenue side more broadly that we have had lower than forecasted loads in 2024. Part of that is a relatively cool summer. Part of that might be just, you know, various reasons our load forecasts could be off. So overall, you'll see net revenue has shifted down, not up for 2024, but there was that one rate change move. For 2025 and 2026, we have an updated PG&E rate forecast. As always, this one had a net negative impact in both 25 and 26. I think this is relatively real in that we have seen lower energy prices, and that's a very large driver of rates for future years. That being said, you know, this is just our current forecast, and things will start getting more real when PG&E files its first documentation around what it expects for 2025 rates, and that will be coming out in October. So I'll be likely discussing with you, you know, with much more certainty come October, November, December, of what rates will look like in 25. When we look at net power costs, you know, this might be the first time I've come to you in quite a while with primarily green tax. So as mentioned, forward energy prices have been down pretty significantly in 24. We had a bit of a price collapse in the summer, which is really rare to happen. You know, overall, this didn't really impact Redwood that much because you were already well hedged for 24. Which is the better, you know, that's the appropriate strategy for risk reducing, but does mean that you can't take advantage of these lower prices that we're now seeing in 24. 25 and 26 are also down, you know, just over double digits or just below double digits. And in those years, you are less hedged. So that is allowing for Redwood to take better advantage of that price decrease and leading to lower expected energy costs. As mentioned on our previous topic, there was the removal by Redwood's board of trying to meet the 100% 2025, 100% renewable plus carbon-free goal for 2025. We made that shift in the modeling of expected procurement for 25, and that had a positive $4.4 million impact, which led to, which more than offset the kind of increase that we've seen in environmental products for both RECs and carbon-free. And just, to tie it into the conversation we just had, we have seen a price differential occur in the carbon-free market, which has been going up significantly. There is one price for hydro carbon-free energy, and there's another price for nuclear carbon-free energy. And the nuke price is significantly cheaper than the hydro price. And this final bullet is the last one, but it's kind of a big one, has a $13 million impact. And this is that, when we came to you in April, we had only some information to be modeling your 2025 RA requirements and the resulting procurement. And that's due to the fact that in 2025, we are having a new RA regime, slice of day, that I've spoken to the board with in the past. And it's a big shakeup, and it's really changing how we look at RA, how the market transacts RA, pricing for RA, just kind of across the board, really changing the pricing. And we didn't have very good data back in April to estimate what allocations you would receive for RA, what your RA requirement would be, even how different technology types such as Sandrini Solar would count towards your portfolio. We have a much better sense of that now, which is great because the annual filing is due at the end of October, which is only 2 months and change away. That being said, we aren't finalized yet for 25. We're still in kind of the draft form for much of this, and we unfortunately won't get final allocations or requirements until likely mid-September. So we've still got some time to go before we kind of know with certainty what Redwood needs to procure for 25. That being said, what we have seen in the shift of the data has been quite significant. So we tried to be quite conservative when I was speaking to you last in April. And maybe we were too conservative in how we were modeling this, but the end result is that with the new numbers, your position is looking significantly better for 25, with a $13 million change in that cost. So a big one. If we move on to the next slide, this shows the annual net revenue forecast comparing April to now in August. So you can see that the big takeaway here, I would say, is the shift in 2025 from being negative 18 million to being negative 4.7 million. And so largely that is the RA shift. So I'm very thankful that it's changed. I apologize for the stress of that 18 million in April. We just really didn't have good data to model things. And we're also utilizing that information for 26. It has much less impact, but it does have some impact. And so that's, but that's swamped by kind of other factors such as the revenue change forecast. So that one is looking, just neutral for 26 now in August. If we move on to the next slide, this just shows the rate changes. These rate changes aren't very large, but the generation rate is up slightly. That's positive in terms of the impact for Redwood's net revenues. However, the PCIA is up pretty significantly, and that is a net negative for Redwood's net revenues. So the PCIA change swamps the generation rate change for the next 2 years in the forecast. Moving on to the next slide, we have forward energy prices. And so this is getting to what I spoke to regarding kind of the price collapse that we've seen. The dashed lines are the on-peak and off-peak prices that I was showing back in April, and then solid lines are the current prices. So you can see how tremendously down, in particular, like on-peak power is in this month in August. It went from maybe $85 to $55, maybe only $50. So that's a tremendous drop in prices, and that kind of is carried through the curve forward, although at a lesser amount. And so that's really positive in terms of just bringing some more price reasonableness to the market that we've seen in a large number of years. If we move on to the next slide, this is your cash history and projection. So you can see the history in the past. You know, we're still on kind of that positive trend overall. We're going to be building through this year and part of this next year. And then the tick down is when we start paying for RA in later months in 2025. And then if we move on to the last slide, this shows the same cash projection, but just only forward, not showing the history, and also shows what I presented to you in April. So if you remember back in April, we were still, you know, not only being cautious about how we were modeling RA, but it was it was relatively crude in how it was in the modeling, because we were still grappling with how to model slice of day at all. And so the whole cost of slice of day was showing up just after, you know, in that January time period. And so that's that massive drop you see in cash on hand, because we were assuming in our modeling at that point that you paid all of the RA costs in one go right there. Now we have it modeled more accurately to show that you are paying, you know, on a monthly basis when you receive the RA that you've procured. Procurement terms vary. Sometimes you have to pay some upfront and then you pay the rest later. Sometimes you pay after the operating month, sometimes a month and a half before. It really varies, but overall, we're kind of showing you pay when you receive the benefit. And so that's why that line stays steady through all of 25. And it doesn't go down as much because, as mentioned, you know, we were expecting less RA costs than we were back in April. So, you know, I think this is overall much more positive than what we were showing back in April. You know, actually kind of end up in the same place when we go out to mid-July or mid-2026. But at least it's much more steady rather than the ups and downs that we were fearing previously. And that's my last slide. So glad to take any questions here.
Thank you, Jacqueline. Any questions from the board? All right. And then public comment. Anybody hear that? I don't think so. anybody online?
Nothing written.
All right. So we're just receiving the report.
There is an action item, actually, just to receive.
I move approval of acceptance of the report.
I'll second.
We have a motion and second. Show hands. We agree.
Unanimous motion.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. On to item 6.2, feed in tariff redesign. Jocelyn.
Yes. Hello, everyone. So this is hopefully a little more lighthearted topic. This program has a little bit of a troubled history, but we're hoping it has a brighter future. So our feed in tariff program, for those of you who weren't around when it was getting off the ground, it's intended to develop a small scale, so about 1 megawatt, I think in that scale, local renewable energy generation, similar scale to our microgrid actually, which is 2.2 megawatts. And the program does this through providing public pretty generous pricing to these projects and kind of a streamlined application process. So applications are processed and contracts are awarded on a first come first serve basis, and it's a standard power purchase agreement, so there's no negotiation of the contract. It's just take it or leave it. And another feature of this program and feed-in tariffs kind of all over the place is that there's a market adjusting mechanism that actually changes the price that's offered to projects depending on program uptake. So if there's more interest in the program than anticipated, then the price will decrease. If there's less interest in the program, the price will increase. And if there's sort of a medium level of interest in the program, then the price will stay the same. And that's really just intended to find that sweet spot of what is the price that developers need
to make local development happen. Initially, the board approved and we offered a 6 megawatt programmatic capacity. So to kind of go over some more details on the history, the program was launched in 2019 with that 6 megawatts. Then in 2020, the price had risen a little bit and there was actually a lot of interest in the program. Mihaela, my predecessor, was managing it at the time. So we entered into 6 feed in tariff PPAs that year, which subscribed pretty much all the capacity in the program. And that was the 4 Hatchery Road solar projects in Blue Lake and the 2 North Coast Highway solar projects in Hydesville. At the same time, the board approved expanding the program, so adding an additional 6.5 megawatts of capacity. And staff were in the process of kind of redesigning the program to offer that second phase with kind of updated terms. But then in 2021, you know, pandemic era challenges befell both the organization and the projects, and they were significantly delayed. And staff decided to pause the program development because we were sort of, you know, experiencing financial challenges at the time. Those of you who remember that was a pretty challenging time, and we paused discretionary spending. And we really felt like we needed to get these projects to like the construction phase at least before offering more capacity. So then in 2022, the Hatchery Road projects faced really astronomical increases in their interconnection costs from PG&E. And they sort of took advantage of a loophole in the program that we are proposing to close with this redesign, whereby they terminated their PPAs and reapplied for their same projects at higher pricing. And the board did approve that. This was an attempt to save those projects. However, unfortunately, the interconnection costs just kept going up for Hatchery Road, and those PPAs were eventually terminated in 2023. Side note, we are still in discussion with the developers of the Hatchery Road project. They still have site control there, and our hope is to revive that one. So we'll put a pin in that until that happens. But this was about a year and a half ago. And since then, we've had that capacity went back into the program. So 4.5 megawatts have been available, and we've received no applications. So that's really an indicator to staff that the terms of the program are really out of date and need to be updated. So this is sort of a graphical representation of how the capacity has changed over time and what we're proposing to make available now, both on a programmatic capacity level and also per project. So as I mentioned in 2019, that 6 megawatts was made available, then most of it was contracted. The expanded capacity was approved, but not made available. And then in 2023, the Hatchery Road capacity was made available again. And now in 2024, we're proposing to add, to expand the program from 12.5 megawatts, which have been approved, up to 17 megawatts. And that would be basically a 15 megawatts under this second phase of the program, in addition to the 2 megawatts that are already contracted with the North Coast Highway Solar project. And we're proposing that increase because we're also proposing an increase in the per project capacity limit from under 1 megawatt to up to 5 megawatts. So what we were seeing, so we originally made that cutoff threshold because 1 megawatt projects or under 1 megawatt projects have less stringent requirements in the market in terms of bidding and scheduling. And so the cost to RCA for operating those projects is a little bit lower. But what we were seeing is that developers weren't building 1 megawatt projects. They were actually building 2 to 4 megawatt projects and slicing them into 1 megawatt chunks so that they fit into our program constraints. And so we ended up with like managing, 2 PPAs to 4 PPAs for what really should have been 1 project. So we, because of the economies of scale with larger projects, we're just proposing to increase that capacity limit. With that increase in capacity, we're proposing to add reliability requirements for those projects. So everything 1 megawatt to 5 megawatts would be required to provide resource adequacy. And if a solar generator, you know, this program is open to non-solar technologies as well, anything that is renewable. But we've seen mostly it's going to be solar coming in under this program. So if they're proposing a solar generator that's 1 megawatt or greater, then they have to pair it with energy storage. And we are proposing compensation mechanisms for these products as well that I'll get into. So pricing under the existing feed-in tariff starts at $80 a megawatt hour. And then as the program progresses, the price can swing $10 in each direction. And that's via that market adjusting mechanism that I'm going to talk about more on the next slide. As I described, the price, we've received no applications and the price has been at that $90 level for like probably the past 10 months. And so we're proposing to increase that starting price from 80 to 90 and to also increase the maximum that price can swing up to $110 a megawatt hour. And in addition to the, you know, increase in the starting price, we're proposing to add a premium for generation that's provided in the evening peak hours. So we're defining that as 5 to 9 p.m. That's when power is most valuable to the grid and to us. And so we're proposing to pay projects $120 a megawatt hour for generation supplied from 5 to 9 p.m. And that price would also move in tandem with the baseline price. So it could go up to $140 maximum. And this is really our energy storage compensation mechanism. So projects that are solar only won't be able to deliver very much in that 5 to 9 p.m. window. But if they install a battery, they can discharge, you know, over those 4 hours and take advantage of that price premium. And then in addition, projects that supply resource adequacy would be eligible for a $7 kilowatt month capacity payment. So to get into the market adjusting mechanism, this is how the prices change, what triggers are in place to change pricing. Currently, there's in each 2 month period of the program, 2 megawatts of capacity are available for contracting. And if 25% or less of that capacity is contracted within that 2 month period, then the price increases by $2 a megawatt hour. Similarly, if over 75% of that capacity is contracted in that period, then the price would decrease by $2 a megawatt hour for the next program period. And then anywhere in the middle of that range, the price would stay the same. So that's been what's in place for the last several years. What we're proposing to change this mechanism to is not based on capacity uptake in each period, but rather number of applications, because we're acknowledging that with allowing projects, you know, up to 5 megawatts, there could be a variety of sizes that we're getting under this program for each application. So we're proposing in a 3 month period, so a little bit longer program period, and four periods per year. If we get no applications, we'd have a $5 megawatt hour price increase for the next period. If we get one application, there would be no price change for the next period. And then if we get two or three applications, there would be a $5 megawatt hour decrease in the price. I think that's all to say about that. We just felt like these changes were more appropriate with the other changes that are being proposed to this program, like in the price and the project capacity. This is my last slide. So the financial impacts, the way that the prices were set for the initial starting prices for this proposed revision to the program is based on avoided costs. So we looked at the value of what these projects would, the products that these projects would generate over the period in question. And, you know, trying to set prices based on kind of the avoided cost of what RCA would otherwise need to buy on a short-term basis in the market. And so if the capacity is all subscribed at that base, you know, starting rate, then hypothetically this would be a cost neutral program. However, it's probably likely that the prices will increase somewhat, but there's always potential for prices to decrease and to see a financially positive outcome. I think it's more likely that we'll probably see this program as financially negative, but that is sort of by nature how feed-in tariffs work, because they're designed to spur local development. They're not meant to go get, you know, the best deals on power projects, which is what we do in our RFOs separately from this. But, you know, since it's a small quantity of megawatts, it's a limited quantity, that, you know, financial risk to RCA is pretty low. And we will continue to bring individual contracts to the board for approval each time we get an application, so we can discuss, you know, financial impacts of each deal at that point, and the board can consider that in light of the current financial situation. I will also mention that we don't expect projects contracted under this program to really start delivering until like probably 2026, 2027 at the earliest, just given how long it takes to get interconnection and permitting and all that. So I think we're not expecting to outlay any capital other than staff and legal expenses until we're beyond this current financial crunch that we have going on. And I think that's it. Any questions?
It's like voice writing. This is exciting. I guess it's exciting to try something new with it. Obviously, it hasn't been as popular as we hoped, but. Are there any of the digester or solid waste or municipal waste type of generation projects locally that you've heard of that could be a good fit for this, or any interest in that?
They're certainly eligible to apply for this program, anything that's eligible for renewable portfolio standard. But I think, so we also have the biomet program, which actually offers more generous pricing than this, and we do get to recoup some of that pricing through utility rates. So I think they would probably go for that program, the digesters, just because the pricing is better. But it is also a much more cumbersome contracting process, so, and reporting and all that. So hypothetically, they could go for the feed-in tariff, but we actually did reach out to Richard, is in contact with one of the digester developers, and just made them aware of the biomat program. So they're looking at that.
It would be very cool to see that in our region.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if, I realize this would be completely different use of the funds, but if RCEA has any development in terms of RCEA owned and operated facilities?
Great question. Do you want to answer that one, Karen?
Sure. So, good time to ask about that, because just this week, California Community Power, the big multi CCH APA that we belong to, issued a solicitation for build transfer agreements. What they did, which I think was a good way to approach this, is because there is this Inflation Reduction Act now allows that public agencies like us can get cash payments that are equivalent to the tax credits that a private developer can get for renewable energy projects. Before that, it was really not very cost effective for agencies like us to go out and own our own projects, because we wouldn't get that, you know, 30% or even more tax benefit. Now that we can get that, we're much more interested in it. And we're thinking of the CC Power as kind of our sandbox where we get to learn how to do this at kind of lower risk and lower staff investment and less of a learning curve for our small, lean staff here than if we were to do this completely on our own. So that solicitation has just gone live. So over the next few weeks, we'll be getting offers. And the way it's structured, they're asking the developers to put in an offer for a standard power purchase agreement and then for the same project offer what it would be like under a build transfer agreement where we eventually, we even CC Power, all of the CCAs together, own the project. So we'll get to look at kind of side-by-side, apples-to-apples financials for what those two scenarios look like in the real world with real developers, which we haven't been able to do yet. So I'm quite excited about that opportunity. I think we'll be able to come back to the board with a lot of lessons that we'll learn from doing that, and you'll have the chance to, you know, weigh in on whether we move forward with those as a participant in those projects. And then hopefully that kind of bootstraps us up to where, you know, in the near future we could be pursuing those kind of agency-owned projects ourselves if it does prove to be costly. We're already somewhat involved in that with the airport microgrid, of course, but that was kind of a special case because there was a big grant that paid for half of it. If we're trying to get out there and do it on our own without that assist, it's another story.
Great. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah. All right. Public comment. Anybody online?
Not online.
Okay. Anybody here? All right. Do any further discussion? If not, can I get a motion for item 6.2?
I will move to authorize the two parts of the redesign.
A second.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Roll call vote.
Sean Edwards is a CCA.
Okay.
We can use some change.
Right. Thank you, Dustin.
Thank you.
So next. Okay, what do we want to do? Wow.
Yeah,
that's what was that?
We're
on to new CCE business, which there isn't any.
Yeah.
Is it?
No.
No.
So, end of CCE business.
Yeah. So, end of a community choice energy business. And we're on to.
Now you can vote.
Oh, I woke up.
You're back.
All right.
All right. On to old business 8.1 tumbleweed long duration.
All right. Good afternoon once again. So this is a proposed amendment to the agreement that we're already in. And this is between the project developer and California Community Power that I just mentioned a moment ago. The big JPA that we're in was one of nine member agencies. Just as a recall of where this has come from, back in February of 2022, the board approved us joining with several other CCAs through CC Power to get into a long duration storage project with this tumbleweed project that's now owned by Rev Renewables. So it's long duration energy storage, and what that means is that it can discharge to the grid for 8 hours at a time, as compared to conventional kind of industry standard storage that is 4 hours. And that's just really needed for grid reliability these days. The project's located in Kern County, and we needed to get into this, as did the other CCAs, for compliance with the CPUC's midterm reliability decision that required us to go out and procure, you know, projects that are adding capacity to the grid. The project in total is 75 megawatts. Originally a smaller 50 megawatt project and got upsized. It's expected to be fully online in 2026. Our share of it is just 3.6% of the total because we're the smallest CCA of the participating CCAs in it. And what's happened now, which is a story we've had to come to you with before, is the developer seeking a price increase, and it's attributed to higher equipment costs. And also, they haven't procured their batteries yet. The batteries are almost certainly going to come from China because that's just kind of where the market is these days. There are tariff increases on the horizon, that different scenarios for what those increases are likely to look like, depending who wins the presidential election in November. Because of just uncertainty on that and expected higher costs, the developers come back looking for a price increase. They really kind of came to the table in a pretty strong position on this. So CC Power engaged in negotiation and arrived at something that, you know, not only the parties can live with. CC Power themselves just had their board meeting where they voted on this yesterday and approved it. But they're looking to all of the member CCAs, of course, to formally sign on to that. Just to get into the terms of the amendment a little bit, kind of the downside things for us is the price is going up between 15% and 21%. So there's this kind of sliding scale that allows for what actually happens with tariffs between now and the first half of next year. Also, another kind of loss for us is that the original agreement had a provision that the buyer could share in tax benefits that might come from this project. And at the time that happened, that was something that load serving entities were kind of starting to leverage, but it seems like all the developers have really pulled back from that now. That's something we're not seeing developers agreeing to in newer contracts, and in this case, they just really pushed back on that and said they really can't afford to move forward with the project without pulling that out of the agreement. So that was another thing that we conceded to. There are a couple of trade-offs we got for this. One is that if the developer fails to get resource adequacy as part of this project, which is a really key value to come from the project, that will reduce. It'll trigger a penalty for the seller. The other thing is that there's an opportunity for the CCAs to get optional resource adequacy from the project during the period where it's partially built and start putting power into the grid and charging and discharging, but it's not all the way to its full operation yet. So that's something we potentially could enter into. Our kind of first round of discussions on that seem to be falling through, and we're probably not going to pursue that now, but we might potentially take an offer from them going forward. And just as a reminder, these are changes specifically happening to the agreement between CC Power and the seller. There's a separate project participation share agreement that sets the terms under which all of us CCAs are interfacing with CC Power. So to quantify the financial impacts, under a worst case scenario where the batteries get delayed, there's the biggest possible tariff increase. And if one or more other CCAs pull out of the project, there's a step up provision that we agreed to where if somebody else can't hold up their part of the project, then the remaining CCAs have to increase their financial responsibility and their offtake from the project. We've estimated a $2.5 million impact on RCA over the 15-year term of the contract in that worst-case scenario. We think $1.5 million is a better take on where we're going to end up under this. An alternative to accepting the amendment would be to go out and shop for a different project to get this midterm reliability compliance that we need. But it just really looks to us, from what we've seen in the market, that we'd be unlikely to get a replacement project that could come online as quickly as this by 2026 and be at a comparable price, even with that increase. There's also risk if we were to just say no to this and stand firm and exit the deal is under the project participation share agreement. We have some responsibilities to the other participants there. So we have to go out and find somebody to take over our share. And in the event that we fail to do that, we'd be on the hook for those costs. And that would be kind of the worst scenario for us, because we wouldn't get the benefits of the project. So given all that, it's not a great outcome, but we think it's better than the alternatives facing us at this time. So we're recommending that the board accept these terms.
Okay. Thank you, Richard. Any questions?
Frank? Do we see a net return on this, or are we taking these terms as an avoided cost?
Well, like I say, it leaves us in a worse financial position than if we were able to stay with the contract the way it is, but it just does not look like there's any way to keep the contract the way it is. If we do, the seller would terminate, and they pay some penalties for doing that, but we have to go out and shop for a more expensive replacement for it.
But we at the end of the day have potential to make a net gain on this versus avoiding a net loss. I don't know if I'm asking that right. Are we going to make money on it, or are we avoiding losing more money than what we're probably going to lose?
I'm not sure. I'm looking to Jocelyn because I don't remember what the financials are for this project.
The financial analysis was refreshed at the time the contract was initially signed. It was essentially neutral, like the value and the costs were pretty much on par. Since then, you know, costs have, the value has gone up and the costs have gone up. So CC Power did refresh that analysis, and I'm trying to remember what the results of that were. I think that their estimate is that the value of the products is higher than this cost, but the cost that, like, the low end of what that contract price increase could be, could go up to, but it entirely depends on like what everyone's forecast is kind of different for that. And it's all kind of hovering around the same area, the same pricing. And so some of the CCAs were of the impression that this deal would now be out of the money if the price increased all the way up to the, you know, maximum tariff, you know, the index tariff rate. So I would say it's probably a wash. But yeah, we would have to revisit the analysis that CC Power had done.
So is the main thing that we're trying to, that we come out with, is getting the RA?
Yes. The driver for participating in all of this was legal compliance, regulatory compliance, rather than it being lucrative. I will say, just to put it in perspective, when we did this solicitation with CC Power, we got dozens of offers, and some of them were for pretty conventional battery projects like this. Some of them were more exotic things, you know, like mechanical potential energy lifting things, and pumped storage hydro, and compressed air projects, all kinds of things. This was one of the very best financial performers out of the dozens of offers that we got. So compared to the other ways we could have complied, this is a much better financial performer. And I'm confident that that's still the case compared to the other offers that we had.
But having an 8-hour battery in your RA portfolio, and our RA portfolio, will be of immense value. But the analysis for that has become a lot more complicated under the new slice of day program that Jacqueline spoke about.
Frank, I think what you're kind of getting at too is being required for these midterm reliability RA kind of features, when the cost can keep moving up, it's not fair, right? I mean, we have this requirement, price can be whatever, but we have to have it, but it doesn't really benefit us. You know, I think that's...
Well, everybody knows me. I have a hard time with the little black thing. I don't know what this thing costs. I have no idea actually really what, how many megawatts are coming this way, because that doesn't, per megawatt, doesn't tell me if I'm reading it right. I mean, it's redacted. But at the end of the day, do we make money on it or not make it? Okay, apparently we don't know that. It's very complicated, and we're trying to figure it out. If that's the impression I got from your explanation. But if we're going to gain with the RA, which is a struggle to get, you know, if that is a great advantage, then we want RA. And so the RA is going to become a lot more complicated to get also as we move forward, because there's only so much of it there. So if that's the driving force that really benefits RCBA, then that's fine with me. But in order to kind of gamble on whether I'm making money when I don't I don't know what I'm investing in, and I don't know what I'm going to get back. And that's seems like a weird investment strategy. And so I think you answered the question about the RA has more reason to move, for me anyway, to move forward with it rather than the financial gain, and the not mischaracterizing what you said, it's not like this.
Yeah, I would suggest thinking of this as something we're doing because we have to, for regulatory purposes, that we've looked at a lot of alternatives along the way. What's the least costly way we can achieve that compliance, and this has been deemed the best deal among them. And I apologize for the financial uncertainty and hand waving, but a lot of that just has to do with the uncertainty of future power markets. And this thing is not going to be operational. We're not fully operational until 2 years from now, and we have even less certainty about what power markets are going to look like then. So that's part of why we can't give you a firm answer on whether this is going to be a positive or negative performance financial.
So a lot can change in 2 years.
As Jacqueline said, slideshow is always demonstrating.
A lot can change in 4 months.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I would just add that, the spirit of the compliance obligation from the CPC is grid reliability. Grid reliability is like an insurance plan it's not cheap. And so this is our, small contribution to that. We're trying to do it in the most financially prudent way possible, but it's hard when the developers pull the cards at this point.
Thank you.
Thank you. No further questions about to the public? Anybody online? Anybody here to the public? Any further discussion? All right, we get a motion.
I'll move that we authorize continued participation in the energy storage agreement with Humboldt under the terms of the second amendment. And if you could just also come up and explain why tariffs are bad for the economy, that'd be great. Just add in a little mix of
time. Just kidding. Second. I'll second. Motion and second. Vote. All right, thank you. So item 9, new business, there is none. We're on to item 10, staff reports, 10.1, interim executive director report on tribal energy resilience and sovereignty grant award.
So I have a couple things to update the board on, and I decided to start with bad news and progressively work my way up to better and better news.
Love it.
So the first bad news item is the Fairhaven. Nope, that's the news. Pretend you didn't see that. The Fairhaven 17 megawatt battery storage RA contract was terminated prior to construction. There were many setbacks, and the most recent being the developer not being able to repurpose the interconnection, which was going to, set them back a few years, and it just wasn't financially feasible for them. Richard and team have been in discussion with the landowner, and we're trying to find ways to work with the landowner to encourage other energy storage projects at this site. So we're not giving up on it, but the original contracts is done.
So real quick, what is repurposing? What was the issue there in the connection?
So the interconnection was not active for a period of time, and so they deem it where you have to start all over. Like, you lose your place in line, essentially, and you have to start the application period from scratch. And so it's a 2 to 3 year process.
Okay, thank you.
And then, as Director Tuttle mentioned, our Swell energy behind the meter battery storage program was terminated after a year. And this program, it wasn't meeting the minimum capacity requirements. And so we came to mutually agreeable terms between RCA and Swell to end that agreement. Since that time, we've learned that Swell is also not participating in the SGIP program, which they were very active in Humboldt County. We have heard that there's another company very interested in offering that service in Humboldt County. And so we've been reaching out and making contacts just to make sure that those services are still being offered to our residents. And then I just wanted to let this group know that the climate action plan is ready for public comment. It just so happens their public meeting coincides with our CAC meeting time, September 10th. So we made the decision with consulting with our CAC that we're gonna postpone our meeting so that our CAC can participate in the public comment period for the climate action plan. So I'm sure all of you will be hearing about it from your respective councils and boards, but September 10th will be that public comment meeting. And then TERRAS, the Tribal Energy Resilience and Sovereignty Grant. I sent out an email to everyone letting you know that we were selected for funding. It is moving like the speed of light. We were notified by the Department of Energy that they're hoping to negotiate an award with our CEA prior to any changes in administration. And so they have been reaching out and we're working quite diligently to get those negotiations underway. So we may have something to bring to the board fairly soon on that funding award. And then now, next slide, please. that wasn't even next slide. But I'll just get to this. There is even better news. I'll break it up. But Director Bauer had asked for an update on Sandrini, and thanks for Jocelyn asking for proof.
Richard did, and I just rang them.
Yeah, thank you both of you. I feel like we've been burned so many times that we wanted to actually see that the modules are being installed. So here is your feel-good pictures of the day. There's another next slide.
I mean, AI is pretty good.
I think maybe some like zoomed in pictures.
Yeah.
Next slide, please. So we are on track. It's so hard to say without knocking on wood for a commercial operation November 1st.
Wow. So.
And then Morgan news. Yesterday, the administrative law judge for the CPUC issued a proposed decision to split Rural Wren into Rural Wren North and Rural Wren Central, with a proposed budget of Rural Wren North will be $33.1 million over essentially 3 years. We will have funding this year to start implementation and doing all the administrative work that we need to do. So next steps are a comment period that ends September 10th, I believe, and then reply period, and then it could be voted on as early as September 26th by the commissioners. So
excellent.
We will have some items to bring before the board, maybe as soon as September for TERRAS and
So the approved Rural Wren North budget is a little more than what we had asked for in our petition. Mm-hmm. So it is really good.
Yeah. And we've been working really closely with the partners, and it has been a very great working relationship. So We're all feeling very excited and hopeful. Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah, that's It seems forgot about the first two.
Right. Thank you. Any questions? Comments? All right. Thank you for the report. We'll move on to future agenda items. Anybody have anything? Okay. It's not. We'll have plenty to talk about next week.
Yes.
All right. Item 12, closed session. Public employment pursuant to government code section 54957, executive director recruitment. Do you have any public comment?
No, it's
all right. We'll move to closed session and we'll reconvene to open session.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm going to just ask. Christine, can you hear me? You're just on my laptop right now. We're just getting set up. It'll be a couple minutes.
Good job. You're natural.
You're like this.
All right.
Run free.
It doesn't rotate. You guys don't get any of the packets.
Yeah, I can't.